On behalf of the organizers, I would like to welcome all the participants of our conference. The co-organizers of the event are the Diplomatic Academy of the Russian Foreign Ministry and the China Foreign Affairs University. It is a honor and a privilege for us to take part in this conference. Its agenda takes on special relevance. I'm sure our discussions will generate fresh ideas. They are important today when the world has entered a new stage in its development. And at this stage, a more just polycentric system is been established. I'd like to give the floor for welcome address to Professor Oleg Ivanov, Vice Rector for Research of the Diplomatic Academy of the Russian Foreign Ministry.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well?
Yeah, everything is okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your introduction. I'd like to welcome Vice President Gao Fei, colleagues both in Russia and in China, and our guests who kindly agreed to start to join to hold this conference. This is first event that we hold together with our partners at China Foreign Affairs University. And I do hope that this is the first but not last event. And today we'll pave the way to more discussions, conferences in the future. Now, in my welcome address, I would like to touch upon some issues connected with the topic of the conference. This century, it has become obvious that the world's geopolitical and geoeconomic weight has moved to the Pacific, and to a great extent, the states that are located there will shape the multipolar architecture. The integration processes and mutually beneficial economic cooperation create a solid foundation for promotion stability and prosperity in this part of the world. However, the United States and its allies and partners came up with the concept of the so-called rules-based international order that is implemented to subvert the norms of international law and to slow down the transition towards multipolarity. Along with that, the United States promoted the concept of Indo-Pacific region in order to disrupt the Chinese project of One Belt, One Road to contain China. Besides, the great power competition considerably aggravated many of the region's problems and security risks. The Asia-Pacific was the first to be hit by the global COVID-19 pandemic, which has put its political and economic order even under more stress. Nevertheless, the nations of the region, notably China, have dealt with this block of the 21st century most effectively. Our country has consistently advocated an atmosphere of constructive cooperation and greater stability, including in the military and political spheres. In particular, Russia unilaterally declared a moratorium on deploying intermediate and shorter range missiles in Asia-Pacific as long as other powers, especially non-regional Western players, adhere to the same principles. President Putin's initiative to establish the Greater Eurasian Partnership, which covers a vast area from Lisbon to Jakarta, implies a convergence of potentials of different integration platforms, and which is open to all the Eurasian states without exception. We are convinced that its successful implementation will ultimately benefit the region as well as the entire global community. The latest Russian-Chinese foreign minister's joint statement on some issues of global governance underlined that the main instrument to run international affairs should be a dialogue aimed at holding together all countries rather than split up, cooperation but not confrontment. In conclusion, I would like to say that I do hope our conference will give a better insight into the complexity of this region and will highlight all possible ways to promote security and stability in the region. Here I would like to stop and to wish success to all participants of the conference. Thank you.
Ну вы хорошо. Dr. Jan?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Ivanov. I think Professor Ivanov gave us a very enlightening note speak. Now, let's give the floor to Professor Gao Fei, Vice President of China Foreign Affairs University, to give us the opening mark. Please, Professor Gao.
Thank you, Professor Zhang. Dear Vice Rector, Dr. Oleg Ivanov, dear colleagues, Dobry Dzień. First, I would like to extend warmest welcome to scholars of a diplomatic academy from both China and Russia, and express my gratitude for your attendance to today's conference on the title of Risks and Opportunity on the Way to Promote Security in Eurasia and Pacific Region. The year of 2020 witnessed a great pandemic and sea in a century, breaking out globally and spreading continuously, which has posed not only a huge threat to the health and the lives of mankind, but also a formidable challenge to the global economy system, exposing many problems in international arena. Actually, a lot of global challenges had been existed even before the pandemic. The pandemic accelerated the evolving change of world order. In the post-COVID-19 era, I think the international structure is undergoing profound changes, such as geopolitics return, multilateral cooperation facing serious challenges, and the international order embodies new characteristics. In the face of such a complex international situation, how to correct understand changes, properly respond to the changes, and actively initiated changes have become a major task for both China and Russia diplomacy. Our world experiencing tremendous challenges and sea in a century, including followings. The first, I think, globalization and deglobalization will continue to confront each other. In the past few decades, globalization has not only increased the productivity of the world, it has also widened the gap between the rich and the poor, and has exacerbated the imbalance in the world development. Although the president, former President Donald Trump has stepped down, but the long-term impact of deglobalization of United States on the world industrial chain cannot be easily ignored. Second, second is a power shift in the world. That the international landscape will continue to feature the rising of the East and the relatively descending of the West. The collective rise of emerging market countries such as China and Russia is a long-term change in this world. No country in the world can maintain its hegemony forever. The new era, I think, requires countries to learn to coexist and cooperate with each other. Only the cooperation and the coordination can help countries in this world to deal with the new challenges. The third, the competition and the cooperation in global multilateral mechanisms and the regional cooperation mechanisms have been constantly strengthened. Although since Joe Biden came to power, the United States mentioned about multilateralism many times, but we must clear what kind of multilateral we need. Actually, we need the cooperation-oriented multilateralism. Multilateralism based on international law and multilateralism and that can promote improvement of global governance and world progress. In traditional Chinese, crisis and opportunities always combined together. The great changes, tremendous challenge in the world also mean huge opportunities. Eurasia is of significance to China's development and security. For China, Eurasia is not only the economic hub connecting the developed and the developing countries, but also the peace and the security cornerstone for regional stability. It is also a bridge for cross-cultural exchanges in Eurasia. The Pacific region is the most dynamic region in terms of economy in the world today. The regional order construction in Eurasia and the Pacific will have great significance to the future of the world, a new world order construction. China and Russia are influential global powers. We know the more power, the more responsibility. We must notice we have special responsibilities for regional economic development and the world political stability. Today, all scholars are gathering at this conference and will conduct frank and vigorous exchanges of views on Eurasia and the Pacific region cooperation. It will be very helpful for strengthening our bilateral cooperation and the coordination in this region. I think as our top leaders many times mentioned, the China-Russian relations, we can expect a better than former. I hope you all can have a fruitful and successful meeting today. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Gao Fei, for your profound expertise and also for your kind welcome and remarks. Thank you so much once again. I know that our distinguished co-organizers from the Chinese side would like to ask the participants to switch on cameras in order to take a photo. Am I right, Dr. Zhang?
Yes, yes. Let's open all the cameras. 同学们请打开你们的照相机，请打开你们的摄像头。 Please open all your cameras. We take a group photo to make a news on our official site. Tomorrow you will see your photos. Please open your
cameras. Уважаемые коллеги с российской стороны, попрошу по-русски включить ваши камеры для того, чтобы сделать фотографию участников. Пожалуйста. The previous list, please. Предыдущую, вот где все. Вот отлично.
Okay. Open your camera. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Zhang, is it okay?
Yes, it's okay.
It's done. Thank you so much.
And thank you. Now you can close your camera. You can turn off your cameras. 大家可以关闭自己的那个视频摄像头了。谢谢大家。
Thank you so much, and let's go on. And I'd like to give the floor to Professor Artem Rudnitsky, professor of the Department of International and National Security of the Diplomatic Academy of the Russian Foreign Ministry. Artem Yurievich, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. You hear me well? Everything's all right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot for a chance to speak at our conference and to present my paper, which is called, the title is Memory Politics as a Security Challenge. But first of all, I would like to express my appreciation and gratitude to the organizers of the conference, and first and foremost, maybe to Professor Oleg Ivanov, who done actually a great job making possible our today's gathering, which was not that easy at the present time of global pandemic and communication restriction. So our present gathering is dedicated to security developments in the vastness of Eurasia and North Pacific space, which is very vital to global security in general. Unfortunately, today we observe mostly negative process here. We know very well that security is indivisible, but the point is that the world, the international community, is now deeply divided, and the divisions, regretfully, are getting more and more visible and impossible. There is still, hopefully, no Iron Curtain, thank goodness, which existed in the Cold War era, but somewhat like that is being gradually built step by step, say between the European Union, for instance, and Russia. And to tell the truth, currently, our chances to get involved in the security efforts in Europe are getting smaller or even practically nil. Security instruments, which have been created in the 90s, some 20 or 25 years ago, now are frozen in a large degree or stalled. Same probably could be said about the North Pacific, which is the junction of three great powers, plus Japan and two Koreas. At the moment, I think there could be found no recipes how to change the way the things are, and what political scientists, because we are political scientists, what political scientists can do. The only thing to my perception is to thoroughly examine and analyze the situation, trying to detect the prevailing trends and some new peculiar features characteristic of current developments. And in this connection, I would like to draw your attention to the security challenge, actually a new security challenge, or even I may call it a threat, which is currently getting more and more harmful, undermining the stability in our regions and making it rather shaky and precarious. It derives from international intentional distortion of our common historical past, inflict harm on opponents and to get unilateral political benefits. I am speaking about it particularly and partially because just want to remind you that I am working not only at the Diplomatic Academy, but also at the, Mr. Professor Varfolomeyev said, at the Department of History and Records at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Russian Federation. And we are at the department at the ministry focused on this problem. and trying actually to prevent possible harm which could be made on Russian national interests and international security in this field. So I will continue. What I'm talking about is usually called a historical politics, or better maybe memory politics. And I think I will not make a mistake by saying that it has become by now a sort of international phenomenon at the beginning of the 21st century. Never before the events of the past have been used so profoundly and cynically to seriously damage national interests. Particularly, I can refer to the interests of my country, the Russian Federation, which most of all, as I think, suffer from such policies. Which are the objectives? There are three objectives of the memory politics. First, damaging the reputation and the image of the country which is thought to be an adversary, an enemy, and subsequently undermining its security. Second, strengthening the position of the state which is conducting the so-called memory politics and using it as a working instrument in the international relations. The third, strengthening the domestic popularity of the political regime in this state, in this country, and exacerbating mistrust and hostility towards some neighbors' external powers. This is three main objectives. I would say that the memory politics could be a good illustration of attempts to achieve greater security at the cost of security of your close or distant neighbors. I presume that the memory politics proved to be one of the main causes of deterioration of the security situation in Central and Eastern Europe. Actually, the events of the World War II turned out to be a huge and the main stumbling block in the relations between Russia and the members of this region. Poland, Baltic countries, and some other members of the region on the official level accused the Soviet Union of unleashing the war, the World War II, together with the Nazi Germany, and of imposing on the region the so-called second occupation after the victory. As a result, the USSR and Nazi Germany are put on the same side. To my mind, this is not a fair play, for the facts taken out of context and misinterpreted to cast a shadow upon the modern Russia, today's Russia. Russia is a successor of the Soviet Union. That is a fact, but that does not mean that Russia bears the responsibility for all the actions taken by the Soviet Union in the past. Definitely, there were mistakes and flaws in the Soviet policies before, during, and after the war, but the picture of the past cannot be black and white as our opponents are seeking to. Britain, France, Poland, and some other European countries could be blamed for the World War II disaster no less than the Soviet Union and maybe even more. And no doubt that without the Soviet Union, it would have been impossible to win over the Germany. As for the so-called Soviet presence in the Eastern and Central Europe after the war, it has been absolutely different from the Nazi occupation, and calling it the second occupation is just not fair and right. In short, it would be right to say that distorting the events of the World War II is used as a powerful instrument of historical battle, which is waged currently in the Eurasian space. If we take the Pacific region, the North Pacific, we can also see the memory politics in action, albeit in a somewhat different manner, but with the same consequences, negative consequences, for the regional security. For a number of decades, we observed the efforts of governments and political elites of Japan to gloss over the facts of Japanese aggression against the Pacific countries, or even to conceal them. The constant efforts are being made to create the image of Japan as a traditionally peaceful power. And to say, it is said that military crimes and atrocities committed by it during the war are grossly, so to say, exaggerated, if they took place at all. It seems that the Japanese apologists to the neighboring countries for its role played during the war cannot be regarded as unequivocal and sufficient. The emphasis in the memory politics is made on the Japanese losses in the war and the ultimate sacrifice of its of Japanese people. Historical and political narrative in modern Japan consider its objectives in the World War II as a, so to say, liberation of the Asian people from the Western colonialism, keeping quiet on the very egoistic aims of Tokyo. And instead of repentance for its atrocities and crimes, for Nanking massacre, or the inhuman and barbaric experiments of the 731 unit, we observe the attempts to revive the legacy of imperial heritage and one of its main symbols, Yasukuni Shrine. Yasukuni Shrine, it is central to the state religion of Shintoism, which mobilized the wartime population to fight in the name of a divine emperor. By the way, those honored in the Yasukuni have also included 14 World War II leaders convicted as Class A war criminals by an Allied tribunal in 1948, and among them, wartime Prime Minister of Japan. In 2020, they were secretly elevated to the status of gods at the shrine in a solemn ceremony, news of which it was a big event which sparked a domestic and international firestorm when it became public. Japanese Prime Minister and other officials' visit to Yasukuni inevitably refreshed the very bitter memories of the World War II and particularly aggravating tensions with China, Korea, and other Asian neighbors. No wonder these countries resent the honors accorded there to the war criminals. Lastly, to conclude my brief presentation, I would like to underscore just two things. First, the misinterpretation and distortion of the past, just to get certain short-term gains is a short-sight policies, which bring discord to the international community. Second, if the tragic events of the World War II are buried in the oblivion, the tragedy may repeat itself in the future. So we need to speak the truth. We have no right to forget the truth, whatever tragic this truth was not. But currently in both cases we face, when this memory politics is used so widely, as a result, we face the progressive deterioration of the security situation, either in Central and Eastern Europe or in the Pacific. And of course, this is making our chances for, mending fences, becoming bleak and elusive and much more difficult. So this was the main conclusion of my presentation, and thank you very much for your attention. Thanks.
Thank you so much. for your for your presentation, and Professor Rudnitsky delivered a lot of food for thought from my point of view. We hope that the dialogue and the discussions we need now will be more about opportunities, but not about and less about risks, taking into account the title of our conference. Please, Dr. John.
Thank you very much. The next speaker from Chinese side will be Dr. Tan Jijun, well, professor of the Institute of International Relations, director of Russian Study Center at China Foreign Affairs University. Well, Professor Tan will deliver his speech in Russian. Please, Professor Tan, please. Professor Tan, open your voice. Open your voice.
Можно? Можно?
Да, пожалуйста.
Уважаемые коллеги, уважаемые ребята, я с Института МО, Дипломатической Академии Китая. Я speak English, let try Russia. Моя тема, это я хочу поговорить о вопросе перезагрузка отношения США и России. У меня есть три ключевых слов. Это первый — необычный феномен. Второй — это главная причина. Третий — это решение. Первое ключевое слово. Оглядываясь на историю, мы увидим, что советско-американские отношения переживали интересный процесс конфронтации и смягчения, взаимосвязано было. Срок пика конфронтации и пика смягчения обычно было около лет 10 лет. Первый — это 1947 года до 1959 года. Это 11 лет с возвращения США до Крымы Трумэна, до государственного визита Хрущева в США. 11 лет. С 1962 года до 1972 года, с кубинского кризиса, карибского кризиса до визита Никсона в СССР и подписания в Москве советского американского документа «Основы взаимоотношений между СССР и США» 12 лет. Свода советских войск в Афганистане до подписания договора о ликвидации ракет средней и меньшей дальности 8 лет. Прошло новое столетие. С 2007 года до настоящее время уже 14 лет. Мюнхенской конференции 2007 года до нашего времени уже прошло 14 лет. А отношения Москвы и Вашингтона останутся крайне холодными с приходом новой администрации. Такой прогноз дал заместитель председателя Совета Безопасности Российской Федерации Дмитрий Медведев. По его мнению, в ближайшие годы отношения Российской Федерации с США по всей видимости, останутся крайне холодными. Это, я считаю, что это необычный феномен. Но главная причина сегодня российско-американское отношение, наверное, нарушает закон, нарушает срок правил в истории. Перезагрузки российско-американских отношений не удалось. Я думаю, что существует множество причин, в общей причины структурные и комплексные. Мы видим, в этом году будет юбилей 30 лет распада СССР. И я хотел бы комментировать нынешний тупик российско-американских отношений с точки зрения распада СССР. В общем, я считаю, что влияние распада СССР на международные отношения продолжается. Прошедшие 30 лет влияние распада СССР принес США огромные прибыль, то есть бонус в тех областях политических, экономических, военных, идеологических, культурных и так далее. США приобрели и приобретает такой бонус, который сделал США единственной державой в мире за эти 30 лет. Но в тот же время такой бонус принес США произвол, унитаризм и гегемонизм в внешних делах. Третье ключевое слово – это решение. Перезагрузка отношений между США и Россией и улучшение отношений между Китаем и США имеет важное значение для региональной безопасности и стабильности мироустройства. США должны извлекать уроки из их проклятных внешней политики и дипломатической деятельности. Правительство США необходимо, во-первых, отказаться от мысли игры нулевой суммы, отказаться от мысли холодной войны, бросать упрямство, деспотизм, внешние отношения. Во-вторых, окончательно бросать унимодериализм. Третье. Правительство США не стремится образовать группировку, чтобы проводить военную конфронтацию. Спасибо.
Спасибо большое. Thank you so much, Professor. I'd like to ask for questions. Dear participants, dear listeners to the conference, you may type your questions in the chat. And in the end of our conference, we'll have a Q&A session. And please mark to whom you address your question. And now I'd like to go back to the program, to the agenda. We had a little changes in our program. Am I right, Dr. John, that now Dr. Lei will deliver his speech? Or
yes, what is, yes. Yeah? Thank you very much. Yes, thank you. Now, Professor Lei Jianfeng will deliver his speech. Well, Dr. Lei Jianfeng is an associate professor of Department of Diplomacy at China Foreign Affairs University. Please.
It's my honor to come here to communicate with my colleagues and my Russian counterparts. Today, I will deliver a speech about Russian diplomacy. And it is a viewpoint of one of my articles published recently. The title of the article is Balancing and Hedging in Two Triangles, the New Trend of Russia's China Strategy. In order to all of us to completely know what I want to say, first I show the abstract of my article. The new trend of Russia's China strategy refers to Russia's new diplomacy toward China amid green Sino-US rivalry, and fundamentally reversed Sino-Russian power balance. The essence of this strategic trend lies in making up for its lack of strength with diplomacy. Different from the US offensive strategy to maintain its hegemony. In practice, it is manifested in the implementation of balancing diplomacy between China and the United States. Maintaining Sino-Russia relations while trying to build a benign relationship with the United States, neither forming alliance with China nor with the United States. At the same time, in order to make up for its inadequate strength in terms of a Sino-Russian relationship, Russia enhances its tie with India so as to hedge Sino-Russian relationship. Seeking dominance in Sino-Russian-India relationship and correspondingly gain more strategic capabilities in Sino-Russia relations. This article first established an analytical framework by analyzing and defining the concept of balancing and hedging. Secondly, it explores Russian elite remarks and diplomatic behaviors, which reflect Russia's new strategic trends. In addition to its root causes, finally, based on the evaluation of policy effects of Russia's balancing and hedging strategic trend, China's response is proposed accordingly. Now, I show the section of my article. First, balance and hedge in diplomatic strategy. Second, implementation of balancing diplomacy between China and the United States and enhancing its tie to India and the high Sino-Russian relationship. Third, the roots of Russia's balancing and hedging strategy. Fourth, the policy effect of the new trend of Russia's strategy towards China and China's cooking strategies. In the end, its conclusion. Now, I talk about the first section, balance and hedge in diplomatic strategy. Balancing strategy. The concept of balance in international relations is closely related to the concept of balance of power. According to Morgenthau, the balance of power has four meanings. First, a policy aimed at achieving a particular state. Second, a state of being objectively. Third, a roughly balanced distribution of power. Fourth, any distribution of power. When the term is used without restriction, it refers to a state of roughly equal distribution of power among several countries. Obviously, the fundamental goal of balance in diplomatic strategy is to achieve balance of power, and it is policy aimed at achieving a specific state that is beneficial to one's own country. The balancing strategy mentioned in my article refers to Russia's foreign strategy that while developing the comprehensive strategic partnership between China and Russia,
to cope with the containment pressure from the United States. Russia tries its best to develop a benign relationship with the United States, does not ally with one side against the other. Makes China and the United States contain each other and strive to become the arbitrator and balancer of Sino-American relations. This is the first concept. Second, hedging strategy. Hedge is originally a concept of investment. It is a kind of investment action of strategy aimed at reducing risk. However, hedging is not a panacea. First, hedging had to cost something, and even the best hedgings had to pay a token. Second, hedging is not a guarantee of future success, nor is it a guarantee that any losses will be mitigated. Third, the hedgers must be both powerful and well-versed in hedging strategies. There are also hedges in international relations. For example, energy exporting countries should expand its energy export markets to reduce their dependence on a single energy market and reduce energy security risks. Similarly, energy importing countries also make efforts to diversify their energy import channels to reduce energy import risks. The author believes that just as the concept of balance of power in international relations theory is derived from the equilibrium of power in classical mechanics, the concept of hedging in international relations should not diverge from the original meaning of its investment definition. This article holds the hedging is a diplomatic strategy in which a country develops its relations with other important partners while managing its relations with major strategic partners, so as to expand its diplomatic space and cope with the future uncertainty of its relations with major strategic partners. Third, the difference and the relation between balance and hedge. Difference. First, the target country is different. Balancing state generally has structural contradictions between balance objects or between balancing state itself and a certain balance object. In order to maintain its hegemonic status, the hegemonic power pursues hegemonic policies. And there's a zero-sum contradiction between the hegemonic power and the potential hegemonic challenge. For example, from the Napoleonic Wars to the 1930s, Great Inquiry is out of balancing policy toward the countries on the European continent prevented Russia, France, Germany, and the Soviet Union from becoming hegemonic countries on the European continent and endanger Britain's position in Europe. Second, balancing and hedging have different strategic purpose. Balancing is to eliminate or reduce actual and potential threats to the country. Without a balancing policy, the threat will move from potential to actual or lead to an increased threat. The hedging country seeks to reduce the diplomatic risks to one country by realizing the interest in two or more countries, where it to develop relations with one country, even if it doesn't promote relations with other countries. At the very least, it will not have a serious negative effect on the development of the country's relations with the hedging countries. Otherwise, hedging would be meaningless. The reason why a country pursuing hedging strategy among several target countries is to reduce its foreign policy risks and reduce the uncertainty of its diplomatic relations with one or several countries. Third, balancing and hedging have different requirements on the strength of the country implementing the strategy. Hedging country can implement hedging strategy under any circumstance and its strength is weaker than that of the target country. However, a balancing country needs to have equal or stronger national strength than its target country. Otherwise, it will not have the material conditions to implement the balancing strategy. Balancing is also very closely related to hedging. First, the balance strategy and hedging strategy can be transformed according to the national strength and the national interest relationship. Second, both the balancing strategy and the hedging strategy will have a certain negative on the target country, and the former should have a greater negative effect than the latter. Third, both the balancing strategies and the hedging strategy aim at enhancing the autonomy of a national policy and expanding diplomatic space. My hypothesis of the article: the new trend of Russia's strategic toward China shows that it pursues balanced diplomacy between China and the United States, try its best to build a good relationship with the United States while maintain the development of Sino-Russian relations, and neither makes an alliance with China, nor makes an alliance with the United States. In order to make up its lack of strength in Sino-US-Russia relations, Russia hedging China influence with Russia-India relations, seeks to play a leading role in Sino-US and India relations, and realizing its ideal and an arbitrator in Sino-US and Russia relations. This is my framework of analysis. Second, I will show the practice of Russia's hedging and balancing strategy. First, it can see from elite rhetoric. First, President Putin's word: there's a good saying in China that when a fight takes place in the Tiger Valley, the West Monkey sits and watches the end. Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov: Russia is willing to mediate and play a balancing role in the confrontation between China and the United States, only when requested by the parties concerned, but it will not impose its own views on others. Russia is convinced of its own potential. Third, Russian scholar Deng Jing: Russia will play a new role by maintaining a stronger but not always consistent relation with China. It means a leading power. All the viewpoint can see from the article, the new theory and policy of Russia, from several authors' work. The main viewpoint of this article is: Russia believes that its strength is inferior to that of Russia and the United States, and it does not want to be inferior to them. Russia should strive to become the leader of the new non-aligned countries and strive to form a more benign relationship with the United States, while maintaining the strategic partnership between United States and China. United countries are willing to take sides between China and the US, including developing countries and allies of the United States, to become the arbitration balancer between China and the United States, cooperate with the informal leader of the inter-non-aligned movement, and become the leader of the new non-aligned movement is the key to achieving the balance of arbitrator. The concrete manifestation of Russia's diplomatic practice of balancing Sino-US strategy for the time is so limited, so I show several cases, not all. First, Russia makes full use of the relationship between China and Russia, which is a partnership rather than an alliance, and pursue greater space to maneuver and autonomy in China-US relations with Russia. Second, Russia and India position their relationship as a strategic partner with special rights. Because time is limited, I will deal with it briefly here. Third, the roots of balancing and hygiene. First, strategic culture. Catherine the Great formed her own basic principles of foreign policy in diplomatic practice. To maintain their own freedom of action without obligation to other powers, Russia exploited the emasculation of its European neighbors and their weakness to its advantage. And to achieve its goals in Poland and the Black Sea without foreign aid or intervention. Wherever the opportunity arose, Russia presented itself as a peacekeeper and an international arbiter of conflict, thereby enhancing its own personal prestige and Russia's weight and influence in European politics. Second, Russia's balancing strategy in the Napoleonic Wars. Third, balancing diplomacy of the Soviet Union before the World War II. Russia inherited a wealth of experience in balancing strategies. The result of combination of relative decline in power and the attributor and the ambitions of global power is the second reason. Third, the American balancing strategy is the largest external environment for Russian balancing and hygiene strategy. Fourth, the policy effect of the new trend of Russia's strategy toward China and China's coping strategies. First, the evaluation of the effect of Russia's balancing strategy. Russia's national strength is weaker than that of China and the United States, and it is already very difficult to implement a balanced strategy between China and the United States. The US is trying to contain both China and Russia with the same force and means, which further increases the difficulty for Russia to balance and balance the two countries. The state of US-Russia relations under the Biden administration illustrates this point. The foundation of China-Russia comprehensive strategic partnership of coordination will be more solid in the future. But the nature of China-Russia relationship, which is characterized by partnership rather than alliance, will now change. Two, the evaluation of Russia's hedging strategy effect. The development of Russia-India relations plays an important role in expanding Russia's diplomatic space and makes up for its lack of strength. But the negative impact of this rule and the warming of Russia-India relations on China cannot be overstated. First, the structural contradiction between the United States and Russia will not disappear just because the game between China and the United States has become the main contradiction between major powers. Second, China and Russia need each other more than Russia and India need each other. Russia's China-centered Asia policy will not change. Third, the US wound of India and India's growing proximity to the US has limited Russia's room for hedging strategy. Okay, in the end, I show my conclusion. First, the new trend of Russia's strategy toward China is a diplomatic response to expand its diplomatic space. Makes up for the lack of strength, safeguard its own interests, and reduce uncertainty of its diplomacy towards China under the change of internal and external environment. So its motive is not to antagonize China or intentionally harm China's interests. And the China-Russia relationship rather than alliance itself means that Russia has the freedom to choose its own partners. Second, China needs a stronger Russia and Russia also needs a stronger China. If China and Russia want security and development themselves, they should sincerely want security and development for each other. Under the background of the simultaneous containment of Russia and China from the United States and the gradual formation of the peace alliance between India and the United States. The mutually beneficial cooperation between China and Russia is more important. Third, because the partnership rather than alliance nature, China should remain open to Russia's balancing and hedging strategy. In the process of developing Russia-India relations, Russia should not give the latter an illusion that Russia wants to contain China. Russia should not give the latter the illusion that Russia wants to contain China. Over the past years or so, the statements of the decision of President Putin and Foreign Minister Lavrov have shown that Russia is very sober and wise in this regard. Fourth, China should formally respond to India's provocations in order to lower the illusion of India, pursuing its luck and its value in the eyes of the US. Fifth, China and Russia should further strengthen people-to-people and cultural exchanges so that the two countries can truly understand and believe that maintaining the China-Russia comprehensive strategic partnership is conducive to each other's security and development. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Lei. Thank you very much. The presentation is very wonderful, although the time is a little bit out of control. But thank you all for your listening. Professor Lei has given us a very profound presentation for this question between China, Russia, and United States. I think next speaker will be Andon Volofomeyev, right? Will be.
Can I interrupt and ask a question? Because there are some questions. There are some questions for the speakers, and particularly to myself.
Yes, I see.
I'm just wondering whether we'll be discussing and answering questions after when all the presentations are over.
I think after one, all the presentation are over, okay?
Right, okay. Okay,
thank you. Professor Andon Volofomeyev, head of the Research Center on New Challenges and Threats, Institute for Contemporary International Studies, the Diplomatic Academy of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Russian Federation. No, please, thank you.
Thank you so much. With your permission, I'd like to share with you a few ideas, a few thoughts on the issue of our conference, risks and opportunities on the way to promote security in Eurasia and the Pacific region. Many experts in different parts of the world outlined that the Western liberal development model called globalization is losing its appeal. The emergence of new centers of power will be a long period historically, but it's already in full swing. It is the beginning of a new era. These stages are never short. No doubt that as a result, we will get a more reliable and secure system that allows countries to use opportunities for their economic and social development. Let me notice that the reconfiguration of the global geopolitical landscape is happening in two ways, from my point of view. One is natural, as new centers of economic growth and financial power emerge. These centers are starting to see the benefit in unifying based on the demands of the present and future, the people and countries. This is how, for example, the BRICS started. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the Eurasian Economic Union, were also created in response to demands of the time. It is extremely important that none of these platforms is targeted against anyone. Their statutory documents lack such a confrontational tone. Unlike this, let's say natural processes, there are attempts to reconfigure the geopolitical landscape in order to prevent the natural course of things and the emergence of new centers of growth. For example, an artificially imposed construct called the Indo-Pacific region, which the United States, along with Japan and Australia, has begun to promote within the far-reaching context of containing China. Professor Ivanov mentioned this tendency. This is a clear attempt to undermine the formats that have been created in the Asia-Pacific region to contradistinguish natural processes. Clearly, the future of the world, including Eurasia, directly depends on our ability to take on multiplying challenges and threats. A reliable architecture of equal and indivisible security needs to be built by joint efforts, taking into account the balance of interests of all countries and on the basis of the UN Charter and principles of international law, including, of course, exclusively peaceful settlements for disputes and the non-use of force or threat of force. Russian officials said more than once that the notion of indivisibility should be applied not only to security, but also to economic development. Russia and its partners in the Eurasian Economic Union are advocating the idea of harmonizing integration processes, and these efforts have already yielded fruit. Russia is well aware that our Chinese friends are working hard on ensuring stability and prosperity across Eurasia as part of the Belt and Road Initiative. 5 years ago, our country's leaders agreed to work on aligning the Eurasian Economic Union and the Silk Road Economic Belt. High Russian officials underlined that the Eurasian Economic Union and the Belt and Road Initiative may be complementary. Further efforts to harmonize their operations will lay the ground for building a new inclusive geopolitical framework in Eurasia. This is what the well-known initiative to build up a greater Eurasian partnerships is about. What is extremely important, it may help not only to promote steady economic growth at the national level, but also substantially enhance security, stability, and predictability across the Eurasian continent. In June 2019, during the state visit by the President Xi Jinping to Russia, our two leaders announced a new era in Russia-China relations, paving the way to even more mutual support across the board. What is the basis of our strategic cooperation? Answering this question, Minister Lavrov underlined that our cooperation rooted in the universally recognized norms of international law that are free from any ideology. We do not impose our approaches or values on one another, let alone meddle in each other's domestic affairs. I think in this regard, Russia-China relations may be a pattern for our cooperation with our states. It is also a good example of modern day leadership and cooperation in Northeast Asia and Eurasia upon a whole. Only 1 week ago, foreign ministers of Russia and China held a meeting. In their joint statements, the ministers underlined that the ongoing coronavirus pandemic has served as a catalyst for a change in the world order and provoked even greater imbalances in the global governance system. Economic growth processes are being affected and numerous new challenges and threats are emerging. The world has entered a period of high turbulence and rapid change. In this context, the ministers call on the international community to put aside any differences and strengthen mutual understanding and build up cooperation in the interests of global security and geopolitical stability to contribute to the establishment of a fairer, more democratic and rational multipolar world order. Thank you for your attention. And now I'd like to give the floor to our distinguished Chinese colleagues. Dr. Zhang, please, would you be so kind to introduce the next speaker?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you, Vafulumeyev, doctor. I think your idea will enlighten our Chinese student, because last day on our seminar, we talk about the question you mentioned, and the students are very interested in that topic. Thank you very much for your ideas and for your speeches. The next speaker will be Dr. Liu Ying. Dr. Liu Ying is an associate professor of the Institute of International Relations. Dr. Liu Ying, Professor Liu Ying, is also Deputy Director of Russian Study Center at China Foreign Affairs University. Now, Professor Liu, the floor is yours. Thank you, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to express appreciation to the people who made this online conference possible in this special time. I think the best way to reduce the risk, leverage opportunity, and maintain the security and stability in Eurasia and the Pacific regions is to strengthen communication and cooperation among all the countries in the region, both in political and academic level. I agree with the opinions that our Chinese and Russia colleagues just elaborated. I would like to do some additional work about the debate on so-called Sino-Russian alliance, since against the backdrop of tensions of the Sino-US relations and the Russian-US relations, especially one in the West is alert to the improved strategic partnership between Beijing and Moscow against the Western countries. It's indispensable to clarify what the Sino-Russian strategic partnership really is and to what direction it will develop. The Sino-Russian relationship has been a focus of international relations study for a long time. Recently, China's rapid rise and the drastic changes of Sino-American and US-Russian relations have led the outside world to pay greater attention to the two countries' bilateral relations, especially since Donald Trump became president of the United States. Leading US experts are in broad agreement that Sino-Russian cooperation increasingly undermines West-led world order and their interests. This perception has even been strengthened since the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic in 2020. At the same time, Sino-Russian ties have developed rapidly on their own trajectory. In 2019, Beijing and Moscow celebrated the 17th anniversary of the establishment of China-Russia diplomatic relations, the year of 2021. This year marks
Professor Liu, we cannot hear you. Professor Liu?
Unfortunately,
Professor Liu, your signal is not very good.
Okay.
Now maybe we can move to the next speaker, and later we give Dr. Liu Ying some more time, okay, Professor Andong?
Okay, thank you so much. Unfortunately, it happens sometimes. I mean, some technical problems. I'd like to give the floor to our next speaker, who is not only an expert, but also a practitioner, as well as Professor Rudnitsky. Our next speaker for a few decades had been working for the central staff of the Russian Foreign Ministry. Please welcome Andrei Malov, Associate Professor of the Department of International and National Security of the Diplomatic Academy of the Russian Foreign ministry.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the possibility to participate in this very important conference. So, first of all, I could only agree that the usual centers of powers are losing their influence. That's for sure, and we could witness that. New centers of economic, informational, military influence have already occurred and have already appeared. And that is primarily the countries of Asian Pacific region. As a consequence, the former Euro-Atlantic countries and centers of power are forced to fight for their place under the sun. Not figuratively, but literally. Despite the bitter political and economic crisis, the Western allies, with growing persistence, and among them, in particular, the US allies, with growing persistence, are involved in anti-Russian and anti-Chinese aggressive strategic line of containment. This line includes a wide range of aggressive actions, including built up in military sphere, military political pressure, economic and financial sanctions, informational warfare. Within this framework, Russia and China are labeled being revisionists. That is to say, according to the logic of Western allies, these two countries put the political, military, and economic dominance of Western allies, primarily that of USA, under the question. At the same time, we are witnessing a profound and very destabilizing trend of deep ideologization of international relations generally and relations of the collective West vis-a-vis Russia and China in particular. This trend is aimed, to my mind, at dividing the West and Russia and China according to a very false and very artificial dividing line of the so-called democracies against the so-called authoritarian regimes. In fact, we're facing the formation of a new bipolar world, but based on other principles. This trend is a reflection of the attempts of the Western allies, and in particular those of the USA, I stress that once again, to impose the so-called rules-based order, which already have been mentioned here, and to control the globalization processes according to their views and priorities. This ideological trend is accompanied by the concrete political military preparations, which is a mirror reflection of how far the Western allies, and again, in particular, the USA allies, could go in regaining its dominance in the world affairs. To make this part of the long story short, I would stress that this could be considered as a long-term civilization attack with proper long-term strategic purposes. This trend is fully reflected in Euro-Asian and Asian-Pacific region. For this region, we are faced with a number of challenges and risks, and that is nuclear proliferation, the presence of chronic interstate conflicts, including territorial disputes, also the domestic military conflicts, the piracy, transnational crime, security of energy supply lines, drugs trafficking, and so on and so forth. Of course, these risks should be faced and managed only on a collective basis, bearing in mind the principle of equal security for all. In the military political sphere, one of the biggest challenges are the deployment of the USA global ABM system and the elements of this system, and the theater ABM. The rising potential threats for the deployment of intermediate and shorter range missiles in the proximity, and this is very important, in the proximity of the Chinese and Russian borders. We have also witnessed the growth, the rising naval presence of the USA. We have very concrete examples behind this trends. ABM systems, both global and theater oriented, are being supplied with new qualitative characteristics and parameters. The tone number of the so-called GBI systems, ground-based interceptors systems, will be increased by the USA by 104. And quite a lot of them will be placed in Alaska. So the modification tests of the so-called standard 3, the 2A and 2B interceptors have been completed, which could present a potential direct threat for China and Russian deterrence capabilities. The deployments of anti-ballistic system TAT, which is a theater orientated in the Republic of Korea, is a vivid example of these preparations. The plans to deploy the so-called system Aegis Ashore in Japan is not only the reflection of the ABM element's practical deployments, but also a practical threat for the use of medium-range cruise missiles with a range up to 2,500 due to the dual character of these systems. So this is a very serious threat both for China and Russia. The number of naval forces, the number of military vessels of the USA should be increased up to 500 vessels, according to the combat forces strategy of the Pentagon, combat forces strategy 2045. So we have a real growth in this field as well. So what could be practically done on a general, on a practical basis to resist the emergence of these threats? Among these practical steps, I could first of all pinpoint the joint political diplomatic efforts, which should be done by Russia and China to promote principles of the universal adherence to the international law, the necessity to find ways to preserve the balance of interests and the respect for the sovereignty of the states. Because one of the aims of the civilization attack we are facing now is the attack for the sovereign states. Envisage the follow-up of the practice to hold Russian-Chinese joint briefings on the ABM and space security issues at different platforms, at different multilateral platforms, like Conference on Disarmament, First Committee of the General Assembly of the UN, and Moscow Security Conference and others fora. So it could be different fora which could be used for these joint briefings. Joint briefings have imposed a very big influence on the audience. So I was present and two times participated in these briefings personally. So it's really an influential tool, diplomatic tool. Strategically speaking, we must continue the mutual practice of joint strategic patrolling of the region by our forces, air forces, by the air forces of both countries. To my mind, it could contribute to strategic transparency. It could and stability and predictability in the region. On a broader basis, I think, and that's my personal opinion, we must envisage a more full use of the unique potential of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. The uniqueness of this organization inherited in it in its creative, independent nature of this organization, which is not a military political alliance, neither is the economic and social rigid above the nation's structure like European Union. I think it's a big, concrete, practical competitive advantage of this organization, which should be used to the full. It's not a coincidence that one of the priorities of the Russian chairmanship of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization in 2019-2020 have been widening of cooperation and strengthening the positions of this organization in the sphere of security and strategic stability. In this context, I think, and again, it's my personal position, we must, both of us, must more clearly shape, and all of the participants of the Shanghai organization, more clearly shape and make them more focused, shape the formulations of the position of the Shanghai organization on concrete problems of security and stability. This is very important. Important also is to find not easy, but necessary ways to harmonize differences of approaches and difference of priorities existing in the organization, both on security issues and social economic issues, with then accent or for the build up of Eurasian security cooperation and stability belt. One of the aims of this Eurasian build is to find mutual ways to preserve balance of interests, forms and methods of regaining strategic stability. Important to envisage the follow-up of some events which have been done within this framework and are envisaged within this framework. In addition to concrete activities within the Shanghai Cooperation Organization and Eurasian activities, we must, of course, both of us, envisage the opportunities of other forum, and that is security forum of ASEAN, the ARF, the Conference of the Cooperation and Confidence Building Measures opportunities, and Shangri-La, a dialogue of military representatives, and other forum as well. Finalizing, I should point, return to the my idea of the idealization of the so-called civilization attacks on us. One of the attacks of such kinds, and we know it from our not easy, complex past of the late 80s and beginning of 90s. So one of these attacks are aimed at the Communist Party of China. But it's not only ideology which is under attack. To my personal estimates, it's the deliberate attack against the backbone of your governance system, which is extremely important factor, which should be, I think, considered. So generally, I think we must use all possible practical and the general forms and methods to be united in defending our interests and in mitigating the risks in the region. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Andrei Yurievich. Dr. Jan?
Microphone, Dr. Jan.
Dr. Jan?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yeah, everything okay. Is okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Professor Arjun. Now, let's give back the floor to Professor Dr. Liu Ying. Just now, we just hear about the 3 minutes of Professor Liu Ying's speech. Now, please continue, Dr. Liu.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Please.
Okay, I will continue my speech. Sorry for this technology problem. I just stopped at, I would like to start from this. Most importantly, as two biggest developing countries in the world, China and Russia are on the way of domestic political transition. Dr. Zhang, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, we can. Yeah.
Thank you. Fantastic. Okay, accordingly, China and Russia, their foreign policies are undergoing changes. Both Beijing and Moscow are becoming more active in international affairs, exercising veto power in the UN Security Council regarding critical issues and deepening their own cooperation within the framework of Shanghai Cooperation Organization and BRICS, that is Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. These developments have led to a fear in international society that China will abandon its non-alignment foreign policy and that the Sino-Russian alliance against the West in the post-Cold War era will emerge. In the judgment of Western scholars, the Sino-Russia strategic partnership is variously an overlap of diplomatic agendas established in the late 1980s. The Western scholars call the Sino-Russian relationship a marriage of convenience, a useful partner relationship, or more narrowly and pragmatically, the result of economic sanctions imposed by the US and the European Union against Russia for its military intervention in Ukraine. Furthermore, the American intelligence community assessed in 2019 that China and Russia are more aligned than at any point since the mid-1950s. Responding to this challenge, the American government has been trying to diffuse the impact from the other countries, but the major drivers of US policies toward China and Russia differ considerably. After the Cold War, the United States overruled sovereignty in pursuit of liberal values, and Russia and China felt deceived and offended by the American unipolarity. Since then, the growth of Chinese and Russian power has set stricter limits to liberal interventionism. After Russia's relations with the West sank to the lowest point over the annexation of Crimea and alleged meddling in the 2016 American presidential election, Moscow has sought to develop better ties with Beijing. Meanwhile, the Sino-US relations have bound to new lows due to the trade war and coronavirus pandemic. From the perspective of the Western world, under the same pressure, China and Russia might challenge the US by means of strengthening military cooperation. Some strategists suggest that the United States should work with Russia to deter threat posed by China, while sober argument claims that the two countries are not likely to form an enduring and coordinated alliance against the United States anytime soon. So in my opinion, as Chinese and Russia leaders and scholars have many times stated, it's irrational to change the current Sino-Russian strategic partnership to a military political alliance against the third party. Because although China and Russia share common interests in the fields of politics, economy, security, and so forth, what is most important for the two countries at the moment is to complete the mission of domestic development, especially in the post-pandemic era. Our two countries' cooperation requires a stable and harmonious regional and international environment. We should not break the stability and balance in the relationship. The current comprehensive strategic partnership is the ideal form for China and Russia to resolve our own problems and address such challenges in the world as pandemic crisis, climate change, terrorism, and so forth. There are also some arguments about the recent event and suggestions for the future development of Sino-Russian relations. The Sino-US high-profile meeting in Alaska didn't go very smoothly. Then the foreign minister of Russia, Mr. Lavrov, paid a visit to China, and together with his Chinese counterpart, Mr. Wang Yi, issued a joint statement to clarify positions of the two countries. They reject zero-sum geopolitical games and reject unilateral sanctions that the West resorts to more and more often. and counter the destructive nature of US intentions, relying on the military political alliances of the Cold War era and creating new closed alliances in the same spirit to undermine the UN-centered international legal architecture. Chinese and Russia foreign ministers ensured that their bilateral relations are safe and are not threatened by those states, which are unfriendly toward our countries. But is this a sign that Beijing and Moscow are going to form an alliance against the United States? First, people don't have to exaggerate the political cooperation of China and Russia, either in the past or at the present. Any diplomatic activity, especially the high-level meetings, high-level diplomatic activities are always arranged in advance. Lavrov's visit was not an early prepared one with the aim to conduct urgent consultation with China. This is a routine meeting in the institutions of Sino-Russian strategic partnership. Second, it is wrong to simply connect the Cold War ideology with the contemporary international relations as a black or white affair. The current international system, in the eyes of some Chinese scholars, is not in the form of black or white. It turns out a so-called color of gray. China and Russia should fully understand the gray so-called gray circumstances and at the same time better take advantage of the gray color circumstances when engaged with other countries so as to enlarge the flexibility of policy and strengthen our friendly partnership. Third, China and Russia should learn from historical lessons and make Sino-Russia relations develop smoothly, friendly, and healthily, rather than resort to extreme ways. The relationship should be developed on the foundation of some basic principles, that is, mutual respect, equality, and mutual benefit, non-alignment, no confrontation, no conflicts, no targeting on the third party, maintaining everlasting friendship. Fourth, correctly addressing conflicts among major powers, China, Russia, and the United States should put all efforts to build a friendly interactive relationship while peacefully competing in some fields. In the three great powers can engage and cooperate with each other and take responsibility in the fields of security, we can curb the momentum of arms race through negotiation and set up a new framework for peace and security that will bring about more peace and stability for the world. In this way, China and Russia can make a contribution to the security in the Eurasia and Pacific regions. So I would like to conclude my speech at this point. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Liu. Dear Andong, I think I have a suggestion since this speaker is from China side. Let's next speaker, Peter Zivitov, deliver his speech, okay?
Okay, thank you so much. In this case, so let me give the floor to Associate Professor of the Department of International Relations of the Diplomatic Academy of the Russian Foreign Ministry, Piotr Yurievich Tsvetov.
Good afternoon, colleague. The subject of my report is as follows: new challenges to peace and stability in the Asia-Pacific region, NATO shifts in the South China Sea. According to many international experts, 2021 may be marked by unprecedented invasion of NATO warships in the Western Pacific. Until now, part of this water area, primarily the South China Sea, was considered as an area of confrontation between the United States and China. However, the manifestation of bloc solidarity and the subordination of NATO countries to the main player in the alliance, the United States, can be witnessed. The dispute over the ownership of the islands and the rocks in the South China Sea has attracted the attention of the world community relatively recently, since the mid-1970s. At that time, the first cases of clashes between the Chinese and Vietnamese troops over the Paracel Islands appeared. After the adoption of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea in 1982, the countries of Southeast Asia, Vietnam, Malaysia, and the Philippines, and China, officially declared their rights to the islands in the South China Sea. The dispute is still unresolved, but the ASEAN countries and Beijing are negotiating the adoption of a code of conduct for the parties in the South China Sea, which is designed to ensure stability in the region and resolve all disputed issues through peaceful diplomatic means. China considers 80% of the South China Sea as its own territory. The United States do not agree with these claims and carry out operations in this sea by the ships of the Seventh Fleet to ensure freedom of navigation. In fact, the activity of the United States military in the Western Pacific is part of Washington's broad line to counter the rise of China's role in regional and global politics. Until recently, the North Atlantic Alliance did not pay attention to the region of the South, East, and East Asia. The leaders of the organization were aware that the South China Sea is not included in the area of responsibility of the North Atlantic Bloc. In January 2016, General Peter Pavel, who chairs the NATO Military Committee, said that the alliance would not intervene militarily in the South China Sea territorial disputes because it has no legal platform to do so. We are trying to stay as much within our region and not interfere in other regions' issues, he said. The years that have passed since the statement have made certain adjustments to the position of the leaders of the bloc. The topic of the Chinese threat gradually took its place in the NATO discourse. NATO Secretary General Stoltenberg, in an interview with Spiegel in April 2019, drew attention to the growth of China's power, including military power. However, according to him, NATO is not going to interfere in the conflict in the South China Sea. It is not a question of NATO expanding in the direction of the South China Sea. To the contrary, the Chinese are getting closer to us. They perform naval maneuvers in the Mediterranean Sea, the Baltic Sea, and the Far North, he said. But with the advent of the president, of President Trump in the White House, anti-Chinese sentiment began to gain strength, and the Americans began to put pressure on NATO allies quite openly, urging them to change the policy of countering the rise of China. However, until very recently, the NATO leaders did not have a clear position on this issue. NATO Secretary General Stoltenberg in Australia in August 2019 said that aliens' presence in the Indo-Pacific region is necessary in order to solve the problems arising from China's assertive policy. NATO needs to understand the application of China's growing power around the world, including those areas that may challenge members of the North Atlantic security body, he said. This statement should be understood as follows. Given that China in the South China Sea and the Taiwan Strait is clearly challenging military presence of the United States, which is a NATO member, the organization will not stand by. And in June 2020, Mr. Stoltenberg stated in a newspaper interview, NATO allies must face the challenge together. In February 2021, at the Munich conference, the NATO Secretary General reinforced the Chinese team, calling the rise of China a serious challenge for the bloc's countries. In his discourse, China's importance to NATO is certainly grown up. the rise of China is a defining issue for the transatlantic community. These potential consequences for our security, our prosperity, and our way of life, he said. The Joe Biden administration has continued Trump's anti-China policy. They have also managed to convince its NATO partners to stick to a common cause to counter the rise of China. And now there is information that in the new concept document called NATO 2030, China will be ranked among the main military threats. Also, the NATO leaders did not say anything about the military response to the rise of China. It is obvious that the armed forces of individual NATO members are moving to their starting position in South China Sea. In the waters of the South China Sea in February, the nuclear submarine of the French Navy, Emerald, entered, followed by the landing ship Tonnerre and the frigate Surcouf. The plan for these ships is to patrol the area for the several months. In a few days in April, the French ships will take part in joint drills with the ships of the United States, Australia, Japan, and India in the Bay of Bengal. It was announced that the German frigate would sail to Asia in August 2021 and cross the South China Sea. The United Kingdom is sending an aircraft carrier group to the Western Pacific, led by its largest aircraft carrier, the Queen Elizabeth. The task of the aircraft carrier crew is to take part in joint exercises with the United States and Japanese Navy. The Navy ships of these three NATO countries are bound to perform joint exercises with the ships of the United States 7th Fleet, including the aircraft carriers Theodore Roosevelt and Nimitz, which have long been present in this part of the Pacific Ocean. Official representatives of France, Germany, and the United Kingdom motivate the sending of warships to the Western Pacific by the necessity to ensure freedom of navigation in South China Sea, as well as to protect the rules-based international order. Someone can ask a question. Can a few ships of France, Germany, and Great Britain play a role in the military confrontation with China, which today has the largest fleet of ships in the world? The warships of the three NATO countries joining the detachment of ships in the United States 7th Fleet may not lead to a decisive advantage of the NATO forces over the China Navy, but they certainly create additional difficulties for the Chinese army. For the United States, in any case, it will be a support. European NATO members can help the American ally by taking on more responsibility on the European continent, thereby giving the Pentagon the opportunity to move its forces to the Pacific region if necessary. Thus, the conflict in South China Sea, which began as a dispute between Asian countries over the ownership of deserted islands and the lifeless rocks, has every chance to become a global one because of the nature of the NATO bloc. The transformation of local dispute into a global military conflict cannot but worry everyone who cares about peace. Some time ago, the expert community discussed the topic of how China should treat the NATO's eastward expansion. It was argued that the closer NATO is to Russia's borders, the closer the alliance is to China. Today, it can be suggested that NATO warships and aircraft have come closer to the borders of China, but not from the west, but from the southeast. It is possible that in some time they may reach the far eastern borders of Russia. The response to such actions of the military bloc should be joint actions of Beijing and Moscow. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Tsvetov. I think our students acquired a unique opportunity to penetrate even into some problems of international maritime security. Thank you so much once again. Dr. Zhang?
Okay, I will be the last speaker. Thank you very much.
Sorry to interrupt you, but let me introduce you. Dr. Zhang Zhang, lecturer of the Department of Diplomacy and Secretary General of Russia Studies Center at China Foreign Affairs University, Beijing, China. Thank you so much. I'd like to express our deep gratitude to you for the initiative to organize this very event. Thank you so much. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Well, dear friends, dear Professor Ivanov, dear Professor Gaofei, can you, dear classmates, dear students, can you see my presentation? Can you hear me?
Yeah,
we do.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you, Dr. Andong. Thank you. First of all, I would like to say thank you to Professor Ivanov and Professor Gao Fei, because our China Foreign Affairs University and the Diplomatic Academy of Russian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we have a very long and very friendly cooperation. And during the pandemic, the COVID-19, because going overseas is a very difficult thing. So we organize this meeting, and this meeting can be successful holding. I think we should thanks for Professor Ivanov, Dr. Gaofei, and also for our Russian colleagues. This is at the very first beginning, we would like to say through the COVID-19, our very friendly and very friendly cooperation is still going on between our two universities. And I also want to Diplomatic Academy a few years ago, that academic atmosphere is very impressive for me. Thank you very much, and thank you to see all the professors and the colleagues online. Next, I would share my presentation with you. I would like to talk about how China and Russia respond towards America's foreign policy in Eurasia and the Pacific region. Take some data findings. Well, my presentation will maybe cover some question like, how is the common for President Biden? Because Biden say some very tough word for Mr. Putin and our president, and also our president. The second is U.S. relation tendency in a very short or middle term from data findings. We cannot predict for a long term, but we can predict it from a short or middle terms. The third point maybe U.S. maybe is upgrading more comprehension action towards Russia while in the Eurasia region. And China also the same to the Indo-Pacific and Pacific region. And what kind of source, for example, Russian will take actively and passively? This is maybe we would like to think and to find. Fourth is how to seek to cooperate in a very conflict situation. Well, two has a very confrontation. Well, three countries also are very in a complicated situation. How is the gaming of being great powers in fields such like military, economy, diplomacy, and the regional hotspots? Well, first of all, I would like to share, now American president is the oldest from the American history. And in China, we have a saying, 30 years ago, you stay in the east, east shower, and 30 years later you stay in another point, in another place. That means situation changes very quickly. When Biden is very young, he pay a visit to Soviet Union, and during that time we found some newspapers, and during that time it is the time of Brezhnev during his very old age, but not very, but not as old as Biden now. I think it's 73 years old in 1979 that time. But American newspaper and Western newspaper say a lot about the old man policy. Old man can govern the country very well. But now you can see Biden is the oldest president in American history. Well, a few days ago, you can even see that Biden, when he go upstairs, there are some accidents. So it's, and Putin also give some comment. So be very healthy, Biden. That means Biden, in America now, there are some data fundings. A lot of person worried about Biden, whether Biden can finish his president term. So it's very hard to predict the long-term relation. Let's see some fundings for the short term or middle term. We can see there is a very interesting team for Biden administration. We call it a new old team. Biden administration is pursuing a hardline policy with both Russia and China. Mr. Biden has peopled his national security team with individuals who are known for their hardline views. For example, Blinken is very hard for Russia, and also very hard for China. Blinken joined many activities. Ukraine issues, for example, and another is, for example, Victoria Nuland. She's also very tough to Russia, especially on the Ukraine affairs and the Crimea issues, and Tai Chi, and another is Campbell. He's also very tough, and now he works on the National Security Council. It was during Obama administration, when Campbell, then Assistant Secretary of State for Asia, come up with the idea of pivot towards Asia, to turn back to Pacific region. So all of the members, almost they are core members of Obama's diplomatic team. They have very rich diplomatic experience, very tough on China, and very tough on Russia. But this team is more rational than Pompeo, of course. And now we can feel that in China, nationalism is in a very high level. I think our Russian friends also pay attention to this picture. Director Yang now is very popular, especially online. Biden's Secretary of State, Blinken, mismanaged the first day of important talks with his Chinese counterpart in Alaska, Anchorage, with Director Yang and Mr. Wang Yi. Because just two days or one day before the talk, American announced economic sanctions against 2,000 Chinese officials. This is very unfriendly. So Biden also say some very tough words towards Russian. Since time is limited, I will not use many time. For example, Biden say in an interview that Mr. Putin, President Putin is a killer, and Biden also say some very tough word against China, or say some China is the competitor towards United States. So from the data, we find that China and Russia handled the pandemic better than US. We can see a Pew Research Center that few say the US handled the pandemic well in countries, well, in the world. But we can see that in China and in Russia, we have very good vaccine. And I think in China, we also think that in Russia, you managed to handle the pandemic better, especially better than the Western countries. And now in especially, I pay attention to some more data in Nevada Center. President Putin is very in a very good attitude in the world, and Biden is very in a very low attitude in the world, and Trump is also in a low attitude in the world. Very low price in the world. And nowadays, China and the United and nowadays American mostly likely to China, Russia, Iran as the greatest U.S. enemy. This is from a recent trend. For example, now China or Russian is the first enemy of to the United States, to the Americans, and China is the second one. But we can see that Americans' opinion of China now is in a very low level. From the 1979 to this year, it is the lowest level. And the basic findings also showed almost the very similar. Since time is limited, I will not use many time here. And in Russia, we can also see that Russian attitude towards American is a little bit better, but still in a very low level. And so the United States will strengthen the alliance building, and China and Russia will be under strong pressure from the United States, but pressure will come from different sources. For example, Central Asia, for example, Indo-Pacific region. Now, American is building more strong alliance with the Korea, with Japan, and Japan is building more cooperation with India. They cooperate in different fields. But now, still, there are some space for China, United States, and Russia to cooperate. For example, well, on Friday, Biden said that Putin and Xi Jinping are invited to the Global Leaders Climate Summit in April. They are invited there. we can also see there are many other fields. For example, the nuclear era, for example, the terrorism and other field, they can cooperate. I think what China and Russia should do in this region to make more opportunity and make the challenges also to opportunities, that is China and Russia encourage each other to develop relation with US, which will not harm to bilateral relation. The cooperation between China and Russia in international arena is based on a common point of coordination. And the UN will cooperate with Russia, and in multilateral platform, we can cooperate with each other. For example, Shanghai Cooperation Organization and the BRICS. This is in the international level. And I think most of you might not pay attention to the trade between China and Russia, cross-border trade, especially the regional cooperation. Well, China's northernmost free trade area adjacent to Russia's has maintained very stable in 2020, despite the COVID-19's impact. Well, very robust development in e-commerce has been a major robot boost for the local economy. And all of us know that last year the economy is very bad globally, but China and Russia's trade has been has been still a very strong and robust performance. So you can see this is Heihe e-commercial, very many Russian Chinese e-commercial companies to settle in this very special area, but because the favorable policy such as zero rent and the low shipping expenses. So this is also one part of Russian and China cooperate in the Pacific region. This is can also be enlarged. So this is very important. I think I stop here and later we can give more opportunity to students. Thank you. Thank you very much for your listening.
Thank you so much, Dr. Zhang, for your brilliant presentation. And especially, I'd like to draw the attention of our audience that one of your theses was about economy. And we still remember one of Marxism theses that economy is the basis for every social relationships, including international security, guaranteeing of international security. Thank you so much once again. And I see that we have about 18 questions in the chat. Unfortunately, due to the time limit, I think that once again, unfortunately, we won't be able to answer all the questions. What would you suggest? How to choose the questions for our speakers to answer? What do you think?
Oh, Dr. Andong, I think there are quite a few questions towards Dr. Rudnitsky, right?
Rudnitsky, Artem Yurievich, yeah.
Right, I'm
yes,
here.
Yes, there are quite a few questions to this professor. So I think we suggest that Rudnitsky professor can combine well the answer and questions, right?
Yeah, right. You are.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. So just a few questions, and the first one deals with the. Sorry, the connection.
No. Everything goes right.
Everything goes right. Just I need to see the question for somehow the question. I cannot see the questions in the chat.
I can.
Somehow. So. Somehow it disappeared. I think I remember the question. So the point is, one of the question is how to mend defenses with Japan and what could be done to improve the security situation with Japan and in Northeast Asia. And Ivan, yes, I know, I see. The question was, just a minute, what steps should be made by these countries to make, by Russia and China, to make Japan turn away from the security treaty with the United States? Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, I think that we should not put the situation as the following, just we are trying to bring the Japan in our camp, Russia and China, and America try to keep it in its own camp, because the security situation in the region could be, it is possible to create, to establish it only if it is beneficial to all the countries, I do not think that any confrontation is meeting our interests. And as for the security treaty, and as for the Japan and the peace treaty between Japan and Russia, Well, I think that the principal point is that Japan should, I think, just to recognize the results of the World War II and not to challenge it. I think it is very vital, and to launch the negotiation, to launch the talks on the peace treaty. And because we need to talk. If we do not talk, it will be just not possible to reach anything. And what could be said else? And but as for the current and present situation, to tell the truth, honestly, I do not think that in the nearest future we can see any changes for better. And I explain it to you because at the moment I can see no cooperation between Japan, United States, and Russia and China in the region trying to make any combined security efforts to improve the situation. And one of the main reasons is the aggravation of the relationship between Russia and the United States since 2014. And many security mechanisms are frozen and stalled. And so I am very much pessimistic about the nearest future. This is my answer, and I hope that at least to some degree it satisfied Ivan, who were asking it.
Thank you so much. The second question is addressed to all the speakers, but I would suggest that maybe some distinguished expert from the Chinese side would start, and then I hope maybe we'll add anything from our side. The question is about non-proliferation. Non-proliferation is an important issue in the frameworks of global and regional security. The crisis of the North Korea's nuclear problem directly affects the issue of strategic stability in the region. How do you assess the impact of this crisis on the nuclear non-proliferation regime, and how, in your opinion, can this problem be possibly resolved? Is anyone from the Chinese side who would like to start answering this complicated question?
Well, Doctor, from my point of view, Chinese expert, here we have no expert on Korea issues. Maybe I should ask Dr. Lei, can you answer this question? Professor Lei?
Okay, thank you, Dr. Zhang Jian's conference to me. I'm not the expert for North Asia politics. I know something about Russia. I try to give some new my viewpoint on this topic. I think if North Korea give up make nuclear weapon, the other way is the United States give up its hostility to North Korea. Otherwise, just as President Putin said, even if North Korean people eat grass, they will make nuclear weapon. Because the security of the people and the country were not guaranteed. I think this is also just like China, Chinese people. In 1960s, China is backward. We are poor. We are very, we,
well planned, but Chinese people, the ordinary room, know to make a nuclear weapon to safeguard our security. So I think North Korea will continue this trend and they will not change. Many times, United States said Russia and China should restrict North Korean speed. But I think this is the wrong path, the wrong means. I think the best way is North Korea would be respected by United States. And the United States recognize it is a legitimate regime and not so hostile to it. This is my viewpoint. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
And we'd like to add something from our side. Fortunately, we've got a good expert in the issue, Professor Malov.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, very good. So it's a very complex issue. Yes, of course. The North Korea nuclear program is a challenge, direct challenge for nuclear non-proliferation. But it's not only like this. It's not only this black and white picture that should be taken into account. It could open a Pandora box for much more increased potential of nuclear proliferation in the region. So it's number one threat, and number two threat, it's a direct blow for strategic stability in the region. So these two key factors, which presuppose the importance the importance of this issue for the nuclear non-proliferation. Again, it's a direct challenge for nuclear non-proliferation. What should be done? First of all, UN resolutions should be observed in full. We have expressed several times our Russian position on that. The bulk of this position is that the UN resolutions should be fully observed by North Korea. But, and it's a very strong but, this strong but is in the way how this problem should be tackled. It should not be tackled only on imposing sanctions more and more on North Korea. It should not be tackled by the way of imposing military pressure on North Korea. No, this is a deadlock. The only real way to solve this problem for the long time future is a complex approach to the issue of solving the problems, bearing in mind the complex and stage by stage approach, bearing in mind the legitimate interests of all sides concerned, bearing in mind the interests, economic and social interests of North Korea. So if we take and choose this kind of a balanced complex approach, then plus add to this approach the really robust and effective multilateral negotiation process, then the chance could be to start at least solving this problem. So this is the answer to your question. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Dear colleagues, we are out of time. What would you suggest, Dr. Jan, to take one or two questions, or that's enough?
Okay, let's take one question from from a student from China Foreign Affairs University, okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Great.
Well, here we have a student. Well, she asked, dear professors, I'm a senior student from China Foreign Affairs University. Well, first of all, thank you. And my question is, how will Russian foreign policy in Asia and Europe change in the context of COVID-19? Well, this is a very huge question.
Yeah.
And the next may be very more in detail. Process of leading of the dialing with the pandemic, China and Russia have worked together to face many opportunities and challenges. What role does this play in the first development of the Sino-Russian cooperation mechanism? Maybe the second question is very well in detail. Maybe which of Russian experts will answer this question? Because this is a question towards Russian experts.
Okay, maybe I would ask Piotr Yurievich.
About the
would you mind starting the answer? The second question about relationships between China and Russia in the conditions of pandemic.
As I know, China and Russia have a good cooperation in this field because all these our countries is the biggest countries to produce some vaccine against COVID. That's why it's a great step in our relations with all the world. And in this field, we can make some progress. I think, as I have information, for instance, some countries of Southeast Asia, Africa, bought a lot of Chinese vaccines. Also, we have a possibility to co-produce this medicine.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Piotr Yurievich. Maybe
thank you. Maybe here we have another question for PhD candidate student of CFAU. This question is also to Russian experts. How do you think about the Kemno accident? Is it an opportunity or challenge for Russia to introduce the Arctic shipping line, Severomorsk, to partners of Eurasian and the Pacific region? And will the Arctic shipping line become a breakthrough of cooperation for Russia in future? Thank you.
Thank you so much for your question. That's a very interesting question because Russia is ready to take its presidency in the Arctic Council. So in May, will become for the 2 years period the president of this international organization. And also I'd like to mention that since the agreement with our distinguished Chinese friends on mutual cooperation under the auspices of the Belt and Road Initiative, our idea was to include projects connected with the North Maritime Route in the processes of realization of the BRI. And I know that for a few times our leaders discussed this plan. And here in Russia, we hope that we'll take an opportunity to find some solution of this issue. And I know that last year, one Chinese vessel already made this route, already passed the route, and we hope that so this crisis in the Suez Channel so will give the opportunity to realize alternative routes, including the North Maritime route of Russia.
Yeah.
Thank you. So once again, if we are finishing our work for today, our fruitful work, I hope, I'd like to express our deep gratitude once again to the representatives of the China Foreign Affairs University. Here in the Diplomatic Academy, we do really hope that it won't be the last event, our conference, I mean, and that in the forthcoming future, so we'll have more chances to discuss issues of international security and connected problems. Thank you once again, Dr. Zhan, for your kind assistance in organizing the event, and also a lot of thanks to the leadership of your university. See you.
See you.
Thank you very much.
See you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for your time. Thank you all for your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.